was a crazy night here at Rogers Place as the St. Louis Blues rally back as they're led by Jordan Kyrou as the forward registered a goal and two assists in regulation before tallying the shootout winner. Ben Scrivens to my left as he earned this fall 4-3 on this night, but it doesn't come without some serious controversy in the extra frame.
Yeah, I mean, this is going to be the storyline for this game. Honestly, probably for the hockey media cycle for a week or two at least, if I'm guessing. I think that it was the right call. I'm being a bad company man at this point, but the reason that I think it's the right call is that McDavid. You have to recognize that McDavid does this play a lot, where he pushes a puck into a space, he pushes a puck into an area, he lets the puck travel, and he basically works his way through defensive schemes. He does it against a box, pulls it forehand, stuffs it home. So for him to place this puck into a soft area for himself, him to like get around a D with his speed, is not a new thing. That is the argument for this being a good goal, is that he's on the outside, he's on his backhand. Before he gets to the blue line, he basically pulls it over, lets the puck do the work. He's getting himself, so if O'Reilly does anything to take him down, you know, it's going to be a call. It's going to be an interference or a trip. I think what he's thinking O'Reilly's going to do is just turn with him. Right, and now McDavid's put it behind him into space. What O'Reilly does intelligently, he's obviously a Selke winner, he lets go and with his bottom hand and basically taps McDavid's stick as he's coming through, as McDavid is trying to, I guess, regain like physical contact with the puck. This slight slash of the stick it doesn't change the direction of the puck, but it changes McDavid's stick coming down, so he doesn't actually touch the puck again. The puck now drifts into O'Reilly's feet through his legs, and it looks like it's going to be a Parenko puck or a 50-50 McDavid battle for a puck. But we've seen McDavid's magic before, right, where, here's a seemingly innocuous play, and McDavid grabs it, and all of a sudden he's burnt three other opponents, and he's all alone. But, you know, for all his magic, this time, abracadabra, it's through the pile onto Draisaitl's stick, right? So, for me, he has possession outside the zone, obviously. He makes a play, which is fairly common for him, so you know it wasn't an accidental push into open space. As he's bringing his stick over, O'Reilly taps his stick and knocks it off of his intended like recipient spot, so he's not going to make contact with it again. The puck then slides into a 50-50 zone where maybe McDavid touches it, maybe Parayko touches it. It's tough to really tell on the replays that I saw. But the next person to truly have possession of that puck is Leon Draisaitl. They obviously give and go, work it around Parayko, and the puck ends up in the back of the net. The reason I think it's the right call is McDavid doesn't actually regain physical contact. If he pushes it, gets a stick tapped, and he still at least pushes it again or like pulls it back inside, I think that they call this a good goal. I think because he doesn't touch that puck again, or it looks like it's a 50-50 battle, that's I think why they deemed it not possession. I think this is where we agree on it to a large sense. When does he lose possession?
Yeah. That's to me, I don't have an opinion. I know you're going to think this is a cop-out, but is it determined that he loses possession the second he takes his stick off the puck, or is it deemed that he loses possession when Tarasenko does his stick check but doesn't make contact with the puck? That's where the gray area lies. It's at what point do you determine that Connor McDavid is no longer in possession of the puck?
Yeah, and that, I mean, it's a razor's edge. I think that you got to keep in mind the linesmen that are judging this, they've got 18,000 people waiting for them to make this call. So you either got to continue the game or not. So they don't have the luxury of 25 minutes to debate and decipher and call in extra opinions off Twitter or wherever they're going to seek an extra set of eyes. It's it's going to come down to, does McDavid have complete, maybe that's it, it's complete control. He has complete control. He has control because he meant to do it. He doesn't regain control. So that's probably the ending of the complete control thing. The argument against what I'm saying is that by that point, they're already in the zone.
Yes.
So it's, everything you either are or aren't offside at that point. But, I mean, you can be in an offside position and the play can go on for a while before you touch it and still be offside. So that is why, I'm not going to make a lot of friends on here, but I think it was the right call to call it offside. And I think McDavid, to his credit in his post game, he says, I feel like I had control. And I think he's correct because he has control. He makes a play that is part and parcel for his game. Throw it into space, beat a guy there. The problem is that he doesn't fully regain that. He doesn't actually make contact enough to be like, yeah, he got that back.
And Connor McDavid did say in his post-game media availability that the league's got to clarify some of these rules. A bold statement from the Oilers captain. But one thing you and I do agree on is that the Kill McCarr goal back in the Western Conference Final in Game 1, not a good comparison.
No, it's really not even, it's probably not even worth us going through, but we'll go through it because the difference in that one is they are saying that Kale McCarr didn't physically touch the puck.
Yeah.
Before his teammate regained an onside position.
Yeah.
And I agree with that. Again, I'm not making myself very liked in oil country at the moment, but I think that was the right call as well. He doesn't physically touch it.
Yeah.
This one is different because McDavid is, again, putting himself in an offside position. So he's, like, waiting or not waiting. It's not actually changing anything unless he were to, bring his feet back outside or something like
that. The NHL back in Game 1 of the Western Conference Finals said that Kale McCarr didn't touch the puck, and that's why Nichushkin was not offside. So by that definition, if McDavid wasn't touching the puck, that would mean he was offside. So that's why we agree. It's not a good comparison between the two, and they're two completely different plays.
Definitely. And McCarr could have just pushed the puck slightly inside, stopped, remained in an onside position, straddling the blue line. The puck is in the zone. That player comes out and then he touches it just like at a standstill. It would have been an identical call, right? And nobody would have argued. It just happens to be, and I don't think Kale McCarr did it on purpose. Like, it was just good fortune that he had, like, he was trying to touch the puck. He just, like, hadn't done it at that millisecond that he needed to in order to go in Edmonton's favor.
All right, well, lots to talk about when it came to the controversy, but Darnell Nurse did say post-game that he felt like he let his teammates down. A tough play with 20 seconds remaining in regulation.
Yeah, Darnell is a fiery competitor. He plays the toughest minutes probably of anybody on the Oilers, certainly to date this season. Two turnovers that are uncharacteristic or at least inopportunistic. He hits Ryan O'Reilly right in the shaft on the third goal. Basically, I don't know how much communication was going on the first goal. He actually makes a good read not to go D to D on it. He just hangs on to it a little too long, gets stripped, and ends up in the back of the net. It's a tough position for him to be on, but he's, I think he's a good defenseman. Coach Woodcroft actually had him on the ice in overtime for the Draisaitl goal. So there's obviously a lot of faith in him as a player within this organization and within this team and coaching staff.
Well, the Edmonton Oilers look to put tonight's loss behind them, and they'll have to do so rather quickly as they got a Saturday matinee against the Anaheim Ducks right here at Rogers Place.